to an hour in France in Ashburton, and I am delighted to be joined by Peter Adcock, who will be accompanying me on the piano. So if we could welcome Peter. It's a beautiful venue, but the constraints of the stage mean that we have to take funny routes to get to where we need to be today. Speaking of routes to get to where we need to be today, we are going to be taking a 700-year-long journey, fortunately in just 1 hour, exploring France's evolution as a nation and as a musical centre in Europe. I've always wanted to embark on a project like this, as I grew up hearing my grandparents speak French, and they lived in Morocco as Sephardic Jews, where North Africa was French and Spanish territory. And in fact, my father, my aunt, and my uncle lived there as small children. So this concert's very personal to me in many ways. That first unaccompanied piece was Douceur d'un mot joli, and it's where we begin our story. It was written by Guillaume de Machaut, in 14th century France. And on the face of it, it encapsulates all the stereotypes of medieval love songs, a courtly and elegant display of affection for another through music. However, if we look closer, we begin to glean the true nature of this century. France was a nation torn asunder by the Hundred Years' War as different Western European factions vied for supremacy. And indeed, much of France was under English control at this time. And to add to the turmoil, if you know your 14th century history, in 1347 and 48, the Black Death, or bubonic plague, began spreading across Europe and killed around a third to half of the population. In Douceur d'un mot joli, we see Machaut talk of love as an enemy in war, and even a sickness. And the repetition and growing desperation creates an almost delirious atmosphere. So we're now going to jump forward quite a long way to the 17th century, in fact, so I hope you've got your costume changes ready if we're time travelling. France has taken the last of the English territories by this point. Calais fell in 1558, and the Renaissance has given way to the Baroque period. And we're now in the reign of Louis XIV, the Sun King. The Palace of Versailles is undergoing a transformation that will see it become one of the greatest palaces in the world. And much like England, Spain, the Netherlands, and Portugal, France is in the early stages of building an empire across the sea. In my own personal story, at this stage, my family has now been kicked out of Spain under the Spanish Inquisition and has arrived in Morocco, where later on they would encounter French culture. So our first piece of Baroque France is by Marc-Antoine Charpentier, a Parisian who studied in Italy before becoming maître de musique under the Duchess of Guise, and then the Jesuits, until finally taking on a royal post at the Sainte-Chapelle. Charpentier was one of the most impactful composers of the 17th century in France, and in spite of the influence of Lully, who we will hear from later, Charpentier dominated the French Baroque scene with his huge output of both secular and religious works. His Te Deum is still widely performed today, and if anyone watches the Eurovision Song Contest, you will recognise that as the intro to that. Don't worry, this isn't going to turn into the Eurovision Song Contest. So the piece I've chosen is Sans Frayeur dans ce bois, or Without Fear in this Wood. It was composed for the court, and features an Italian-style composition with traditional French lyricism. It translates as, "Without fear into these woods, alone I came. There I see Thyrsis, and was not stirred. Ah, can I bring nothing to bear? For a young heart without feeling is to be lamented. While I do not seek danger in the least, I would at least like to fear it." So this is Sans Frayeur dans ce bois.
Thank you.
So we're going to remain in the Baroque period, and we're still under the reign of the Sun King. And we're now going to join Jean-Baptiste Lully, who was an Italian-born composer, who composed for the French court through much of the 17th century. He is one of the most famous French composers and was hugely influential at the time. An innovator, his collaborations with the playwright Molière produced a new style, the comedy ballet. But he was perhaps best known for his operas. So the piece that I'm going to be performing is from his opera Assis Egalite, and it's entitled Qu'une injuste fierté. Unlike the tragedies in most of his operas, this work is referred to as pastoral héroïque, because it's pastoral theme and slightly altered format. It's taken from classical mythology, and the story is of a love triangle between the three main characters. We have Assis, who is a mortal, Galatea, a sea nymph, and Polyphem, who is a monster. That is not a reflection on their personality, that is just a statement. Polyphem murders Assis out of jealousy, but Assis is revived and turned into a river by the god Neptune. In this piece, we join Galatea proclaiming that an unjust bride causes us constraints and tyrannizes our desires.
Thank you.
came to my last concert tour, you might recognise the last piece. It was Ombre de mon amour, or Shadow of My Love, and it's by Michel Lambert, and it was composed during the late 17th century. It's an intense and pained love song, like a lot of Baroque pieces. And it translates as follows: Shadow of my beloved, ever mournful shadow, alas, what do you want? I am dying. Pay attention for a while to the fatal story of my sharp pains. It is on this fatal shore that I saw your blood flow with my tears. Nothing can stop my fugitive soul. I give in to my cruel misfortunes. Lambert was just as influential as Charpentier and Lully, but perhaps less well known today. Aside from being a composer, he was a ballet dancer in the court of Louis XIV, and he took the title of Maître de Musique de la Chambre du Roi. And so in this royal position, he worked very closely with Lully, who had in fact married his daughter Madeleine. The Baroque era in France was a period of huge cultural productivity through an influential network of composers and creatives within the royal circle. Vast wealth pouring into France allowed a dramatic increase in creative output, establishing French culture as one of sophistication and extravagance. So we are now progressing forwards again, and this time into the 18th century and the classical era. So on the one hand, this is a period of great opulence and imperial expansion, but on the other, of great divisions. So by the end of the century, the country was in the grip of revolution, beginning a long struggle between monarchy and republic for political control. Musically, we also start to see some quite significant shifts. The piano is more widely used in performance and composition, so the pieces you've heard so far would have mostly been with harpsichord. And also the French chanson becomes more popular outside of France, which leads us nicely onto the next piece. So Dans un bois solitaire, by none other than Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart, is an ariette that deliberately imitates the French chanson. It's drawn from a poem by the late 17th, early 18th century poet Antoine Oudard de la Motte, and it takes the theme of love and intertwines it with classical mythology, specifically around Cupid, who curses the narrator to forever languish in love for having dared to wake him.
Thank you.
imagine France and indeed Europe at large during the 18th century, we often focus on the splendour and opulence of fashion and high society. But what we don't often think about is at what cost did this come? It's undeniable that this vast transfer of wealth to European aristocracy was facilitated by the Atlantic slave trade, of which France, like Britain and many other countries, was part of. And so to our next piece, which is actually very appropriate for this subject. So has anyone heard of the film Chevalier? So when I planned this repertoire, I didn't actually know that they were going to make a film about this, but it couldn't have been more fortuitous. It will be out, it's either out already or will be out soon. Ah, fantastic. Yeah, so I'm really looking forward to seeing this because I've done a lot of research on the character in question, who is Joseph Boulogne Chevalier de Saint-Georges, and he was a champion fencer, violinist, and composer. Now, I could probably perform a whole concert series just about him, as his life story is so fascinating and so different to so many other composers. He was the son of Georges de Boulogne Saint-Georges, and he was a settler and plantation owner, and Nanon, who was an 18-year-old enslaved African. Joseph was the first European composer of African descent to receive widespread critical acclaim for his work. But in spite of his immense talent, racist attitudes denied him many opportunities, and he was denied the role of conductor of the Paris Opera just because of the colour of his skin. It's actually quite difficult to find much of his work through sheet music, but I hope that the film will bring about a revival of his work, as there are many fantastic pieces. The piece I'll be performing is Depuis longtemps mon cœur soupira, or For a long time my heart has sighed. It's from his sole surviving intact opera, L'amant anonyme, or The Anonymous Lover, which is a comic opera about a wealthy young widow, Léontine, who doesn't believe she should fall in love again. And in this scene, a good friend, Valcourt, is pining for her, but daren't profess his love because he is of lower birth.
Thank you.
Plaisir d'amour, which you just heard, was by Jean-Paul Egide Martini, a German composer who moved to France in 1760 and spent most of his career there. He's often mentioned as the first composer in France to write for piano accompaniment. Plaisir d'amour is probably his most famous work, and it's a classic romance that is now considered a prototype for this sort of song. There are many versions of this song, and many of them are instrumental. But one of the most curious legacies of this piece is its role in modern music. You may find that even if you don't know the piece itself, you recognise its melody. And that might be because it was reused by Elvis Presley for Can't Help Falling in Love with You. Wise men say, only fools rush in, but I can't help falling in love with you. See that again. I'm not going to sing the whole thing, this is an Elvis concert. My hair hasn't yet reached that, the Elvis. So we're now leaving Elvis and the 18th century behind, and we're jumping forward 80 years into the Romantic era. Now, as a singer, I have mainly sung Baroque and classical. But I've always been fond of the Romantic, as my grand-mère, once a concert pianist in Morocco, was very fond of piano works of this era herself. So at this point, France is intermittently darting between empire and republic, and it's entering an era of industry and continued global expansion, setting the stage for French to become one of the most widely spoken languages today. We're starting with a piece by Georges Bizet, from Les Pêcheurs des Perles, Je crois entendre encore. Now, the work is set in Sri Lanka, ancient Sri Lanka, and it's the story of two men's friendship being tested by their love for the same woman. And in the song, one of the fishermen, Nadir, recalls how he has broken his promise and pursued love for this woman, Layla, who is a young priestess. I actually first heard this piece while watching a fairly recent film, The Father, with Olivia Colman and Anthony Hopkins. And I was so struck by how, when it was the piece that was used for that film, the tenor singing almost sounded like a countertenor, which is my primary classical singing voice. So I was intrigued to explore it myself. So this next piece is Je crois entendre encore. I have to stay very hydrated. Last time I had my water over there and I had to keep walking to and fro, and I had the genius idea of bringing me closer. to my concerts regularly, which is something I can now say because I've done enough concerts over the last year to vaguely call myself a regular performer. You might know that I mainly sing as a countertenor. But this next one I'm going to be singing a little differently, and you will see in a minute. Our next song is Les Berceaux, or The Cradles, and it's a song by Gabriel Faure. It compares the rocking of cradles with the gentle listing of ships on the water, but that no matter how enticing distant horizons will be, the ships and the men who sail on them will always be drawn home by the rocking of the cradles. Faure was born in Pamiers in the south of France. He was a composer, he was an organist, a pianist and a teacher. And he's now one of the most famous and recognisable French composers. His life links together the end of Romanticism to modernism. In fact, Chopin was composing when he was born and jazz was becoming popular when he died, which is quite something to think about. So this next piece is Les Berceaux. So before we move on to our final song, I just want to thank you all for coming along. Performing concerts like this is such a joy for me, but it's still quite new. I had my first singing lesson just before the pandemic hit in 2020, which was excellent timing, of course. So I then had singing lessons via Skype and Zoom, and I did my first solo concert more or less this time last year, and in that time it's been fantastic. Meeting new audiences every time. And this is my third time back in Ashburton, so you can tell I love it here. It's absolutely beautiful and a perfect setting to sing so many of these songs as well. For someone so new, it does mean a lot to me that you want to come and hear me perform. And thank you, of course, to the wonderful Peter. He has been such a fantastic accompanist. His advice and input have been so completely invaluable in shaping this tour, so we can have a round of applause. And lastly, I could not have done this without my friends and family who have formed the logistical operation of my concert tours. From helping me promote my concerts to ferrying me between venues and scanning tickets on the door. So I owe so much to them. And in particular, I owe a lot to my family. My grandparents, faced with such a difficult situation in post-war Morocco, came to this country in the hope of a better life and a safer world in which to raise their children. From them, I developed my love of the French language and culture. So in as much as my last concert tour was a tribute to my maternal grandparents, this tour is very much a tribute to my paternal grandparents. The final song is Acclaimed by Renaldo Hahn. And I find that this song has really strange parallels with that of my grand-mère. That his life has parallels with the song. They were both Jewish and born in Caracas, Venezuela. Both were pianists and both moved to French-speaking territories at a young age. Hahn moved to France and my grand-mère moved to Tangier. Acclaimed was composed in 1916. I printed it wrong on the programme. This is why you should never do things late at night. Always sleep well, everyone. And the reason I mention this is because it's quite important. He was serving in the First World War at the time as a private near the front line. So in spite of the bombardment going on around him, he still found time to compose. And I imagine it was a bit of an escape for him in many ways. This is a wonderful piece to end with, as it neatly ties up the concert in the 20th century with a piece that, while relatively modern, was in fact taken from a Renaissance poem and uses a distinctly Baroque style of composition. It's an impassioned declaration of love written by Théophile de Viau during Louis XIII's reign. So once again, thank you for coming, and here is Acclaimed. Thank you. So I hadn't done this until this tour, but it's given me a strange power trip. We're doing an encore. we've covered about 630 years, and I think we've done like 50 minutes, so it's not quite an hour, so you're not really getting your money's worth. So I thought, well, let's ensure that happens. So I mentioned that when Faure died, jazz was becoming popular. And jazz is one of the defining musical styles in French culture, certainly in the modern era. But what's distinctive about French jazz is that it takes on so many of the key elements of the traditional chanson. I've chosen Ce Matin-là by Barbara. She was born into a Jewish family in Paris, and Barbara had to go into hiding during the German occupation in the Second World War. And I can relate this quite closely to my own family's experience. My grandpère lived in Casablanca during the Second World War when he was a child. And so many of his friends were taken away. And he told me, I remember as a child, he told me that he had to hide in a tree to escape from the Nazis. And that there was a point where all the doors of the Jews were marked as they were going to be taken away. And it was really in the nick of time that the Americans arrived as part of a huge operation. So, you know, the Barbara's story rings quite close to home in many ways. And then after the war, she returned to Paris and had dreams of becoming a pianist, but problems with her hands prevented this. So she took up singing instead, and she went on to become a huge star. She sold millions of records in the 1960s and 70s. So, I know I said the last song was the perfect way to end the concert, but I lied for dramatic device. This is the perfect way to announce it. And I'm not going to come out again and say that to anyone. We're bringing the classic French chanson into the world of pop, and we're taking us neatly into a recognisable cultural scene. So, Matin-là from 1964 is a love song with so many of the pastoral themes that we've seen in other songs throughout the concert, but it's delivered through jazz. So let's end this hour in France with Ce Matin-là.